the Racial Literacy Roundtable series, which I am going to talk about as I talk a bit about institutionalizing racial literacy, would not be if it were not for Dr. Janice Robinson, who I guess has been 12 years ago, said yes, and here's a budget, and we only needed money for food because you have to feed people. And Janice, I want to thank you publicly for all that you do for TC, but that you've done for me in trying to open up conversations around race and class and gender, sexual orientation, just those social identities that are the beautiful part of our humanity, and getting people to talk about it in such a way. So thank you, Janice, for being here and for who you are.
Thank you, Jolie. We couldn't do it without you and almost everybody that's here, and definitely Dr. Mensa. So we keep each other, we lift each other up. We do, and we try to stay in community with each other.
Love it. Well, hello, everybody. It's really great to see you all, and I thank you all for joining us. My name is G, for those who don't know, and I'm the diversity coordinator here at Mailman, and I'm so happy to see you all for the One Book, One School series. The team at ODCI welcomes you and appreciates your support with this initiative. As we wrap up the series, I'd like to thank all of our amazing faculty members that have led discussions over the last couple of weeks: Dr. Galeen Tamari, Dr. Stephanie Grillo, Dr. Patrick Wilson, Dr. Dustin Duncan, Dr. Rachel Shelton, and Dr. Jasmine McDonald, a lot of doctors. And today we'll be hearing from Dr. Yolanda Sealey-Ruiz about racial literacy and how it connects to the anti-racist tenets that we've been discussing all semester throughout the series. Yolanda Sealey-Ruiz is an award-winning associate professor at Teachers College, Columbia University. Her research focuses on racial literacy and teacher education, Black girl literacies, and Black and Latinx male and high school students. A sought-after speaker on issues of race, culturally responsive pedagogy, and diversity, Sealey-Ruiz works with the K-12 and higher education school communities to increase their racial literacy knowledge and move towards more equitable school experiences for their Black and Latinx students. Sealey-Ruiz appeared in Spike Lee's Two Fists Up, We Gon' Be Alright, a documentary about the Black Lives Matter movement and the campus protests at Mizzou. Yolanda is also the editor of three books on education and numerous scholarly articles and essays. I will now pass it over to Dr. Sealey-Ruiz to get us started, and please join me in welcoming her to Mailman.
Thank you all. Thank you so much. So I'm so inspired by your dean and this initiative of One Book, One School. And I want to give an incredible shout out to Columbia Mailman School of Public Health. Number one, for inviting me, G. I appreciate you so much. And I'll say thank you to you later on. But this idea of a collective community rallying around a book, an article, Teachers College has done that before. I just think that it's a beautiful way of building community, and with that, building conversation pods that people can share with each other, perhaps using a book as a point of entry before they begin to eventually talk about their lives. And so Mailman School's current shared commitment to addressing systemic racism, both within their community, within the institution, and in society, is what your dean has shared, is the impetus for choosing How to Be an Anti-Racist by Ibram X. Kendi. And I am grateful to be here today to talk. I first want to acknowledge the land that personally that I am on. We may be in different spaces. I don't want to assume we're all here in New York and in Harlem, but specifically Turtle Island, which is also recognized or known as Manhattan, or Manhattan, and specifically in Harlem, there were a number of tribes, about 14 or so, that inhabited and cultivated this land. And so I'd like to take a moment of silence to pay homage to the indigenous brothers and sisters, specifically the Wappinger and the Lenni Lenape peoples who inhabited this area. We also see a huge presence of the Lenni Lenape peoples in terms of their history, what they left behind of cultivation in New Jersey, also on Long Island, and in spaces of Connecticut. So I just wanted to take a moment to acknowledge. Thank you. I want to thank the U.S. Department of Arts and Culture for, this is a resource for you if you've never heard of nativeland.ca, nativeland.ca. It is an interactive website that the U.S. Department of Arts and Culture built in community with First Nations people across the globe. And what's beautiful about it is that you can put in a physical address, you can put in a region or a state. And this is really cool as you travel, when you travel across the country, when you go to a particular place, you can find out which Indigenous tribes, First Native peoples cultivated and inhabited that land. And just a constant reminder that the colonization project is still underway, that it also gives me an opportunity to follow Indigenous protocols to enter spaces in person and also on Zoom with reverence and respect for the humans who are in front of me. And so with that, I greet you with peace and with love and a reverence for who you are in our shared humanity. And I want to take a moment to acknowledge where we are as humans navigating life and work in the time of COVID, notwithstanding awaiting results of an election that many of us, or if not all of us, are so deeply invested in. And just being able to take a pause today to talk about the hope of humanity coming together, in this case, around a book or around ideas, I just wanted to acknowledge what each of you may be carrying and some of the heaviness that you may have in your hearts as you come into this space.
The guy about you playing chess.
Okay, do you want to try to, we can try to mute folks. Or if you're just coming in, please mute yourself upon arrival until you get settled. And I want to bring my student into the room by way of thanking you, G, for reaching out to me. And my student said in one of my classes about 2 years ago, you know, she said, part of doing the work is getting others to do the work as well. And so I thank you for the, first of all, I thank your dean for choosing this idea, creating this idea. And I thank you for reaching out to me and inviting me into the space to invite others to do the work that we need to do together. So thank you so, so much for the work that you do in such a brilliant, diligent, and fierce way. Part of when I was invited to do this, and G, you were wonderful of offering different parameters. And certainly I want to tell you that I adhere to that, but I also tried to bring in a little bit of a different spin. But part of it was trying, you asked, I think, to select a couple of quotes from the book that really stood out to me and maybe hit home on this overall theme of the book. And so I want to offer this as one of Ibram's quotes. He says that one either believes problems are rooted in the groups of people as a racist, or locates the roots of problems and power and policies as an anti-racist. And I'm hoping that when we have discussion time, that perhaps some of the quotes that I share will be a portal into our conversation, or at the very least, it will give you just something to ponder and an opportunity to go back into the book if you're reading it, or to start the book if you've not read it, to really think about what does this say to you and where do you fit in with this? Because part of becoming anti-racist is having these honest conversations, and the focus is on the self, which I will talk a little bit about. And I want us to remember where we are in terms of our society. Last year marked 400 years of the Inequality Project in this country in particular. It began through enslavement in 1607 on the British Isles in Europe, in Britain, and specifically here in 1619. And that's the year that 20 enslaved Africans were brought into Jamestown, Virginia at Port Comfort, and marked the beginning of the most notorious dehumanization project that we have seen and we've seen flourish over time through policies, institutionalized through media used to affect the human psyche, to create what Beverly Daniel Tatum talks about as this smog of racism that we all live under. So I bring this up for us always to remember our history and also to remember what we are trying to unravel. And specifically in education, we've really only been at it as a concerted effort if you mark the 1954 Brown versus Board of Education decision. And Lonnie Guinier, incredible scholar, is a scholar at Harvard University and a critical race theory scholar, at one time was being considered to be Secretary of Education by Clinton. She wrote a wonderful piece in 2004 called, it's entitled From Racial Liberalism to Racial Literacy. And so anytime I talk about racial literacy, I must pay homage to Dr. Lonnie Guinier, who really brought that concept, that term from legal studies into education, as did Frances Twine, a sociologist. She brought it from sociology into education. And there are multiple colleagues of mine who since 2010 have been writing about racial literacy, and I add myself, sorry about all the sounds in the background, I add myself to that list. So here's the approach that I wanted to take as I thought about quotes from the book. I wanted to put Ibram's work in conversation with some of the language from two particular people who inspire me. I have many who inspire me, but one is Sister Angela Davis. And this idea of trying to wrap ourselves around, our minds around, what does it mean to be an anti-racist? Kendi says, well, Angela Davis said many years ago, in a racist society, it is not enough to be non-racist. We must be anti-racist. And Kendi tells us, what's the problem with being non-racist? It is a claim that signifies neutrality. I am not a racist, but neither am I aggressively against racism. But there is no neutrality. The racism struggle, the opposite of racist, isn't not racist, it is anti-racist. So I share that, bring in his words in conversation with Sister Angela. And anyone who knows me knows that I am deeply inspired by whom I affectionately call Uncle Jimmy. You know, I'm related to all of these famous people in my mind, living and dead. They don't know it, but I affectionately call James Baldwin Uncle Jimmy, who has really helped me in so much of my own thinking. And I'm going to read his quote, and then I'm going to be silent and allow you to take in Ibram's words from his book. So Uncle Jimmy said, from my point of view, no label, no slogan, no party, no skin color, and indeed no religion is more important than being the human being. So let me give you a moment to read Ibram's words. So as you take those in, just to share my thinking behind this, is James Baldwin clearly is saying there is nothing above humanity. There is nothing more important than humanity. And while we live in a world of slogans, in part because it is a form of resistance, of saying Black Lives Matter, of saying Me Too, of having people sometimes within a hashtag, just so we can draw attention to claim their humanity. It's really about claiming humanity. And Baldwin here is saying the same thing, that no slogan, no policy, not even the social construction of race and the characteristics that we embody, that is not more important than recognizing our humanity. And so I, again, sharing these quotes with you as a way for us to perhaps enter the conversation towards the end of this talk. So what does it mean to move towards anti-racism? I want to say that I got a little creative with this, and I thought about a book that I read a couple of years ago that had been out for a number of years by Don Miguel Ruiz, The Four Agreements, a Toltec wisdom book, and a description of the four agreements is that it reveals the source of self-limiting beliefs that rob us of joy and create needless suffering. And the four agreements were very simple. Number one, be impeccable, excuse my typo, with your word. Number two, don't take anything personally. Number three, don't make assumptions. And number four, always do your best. And if you've picked up this little book, you'll see that it is as a treasure. I read it at a time where I needed it the most. And outside of prayer that's in my life and meditation, this book, which for me seemed like prayer and meditation on a page, really got me through a very difficult time, which is what literature does. So I don't know if I was inspired by the book and also the fact that we share the same last name, kind of, but I thought about this idea of agreements. What if people were to enter this journey of anti-racism by making some agreements with themselves? And so I thought about the idea that the work of anti-racism is rigorous. It is a lifelong journey that is worth the trip because humanity is at stake and humans are worth it. And I thought, you know, what would be four agreements that I could share or to offer to folks? Number one, I would say that one book, as good as it is, will not make you anti-racist. Though we know that reading helps. There's a wonderful article in the Washington Post by Trey Johnson, who it was published a couple of weeks ago. It says, when Black people are hurting white people, he was talking specifically about white brothers and sisters, white people join book clubs. And if you read the article, he goes on to talk about how, because of the distance from some of this brutality, right, and being sometimes the fear of opening up emotionally, that white folks tend to intellectualize this idea of anti-racism, of allyship, right? Certainly they also put their bodies on the lines. You know, we're gonna talk a bit about co-conspiratorship, but for the most part, they feel the safe thing to do, and in part is because our education system has not openly educated us on these issues, right? So we have to see them emerge in fields like multicultural education or critical race theory or culturally responsive education, because we've never really been good at openly talking about this if it's not relegated to a diversity class or a class that's my phone or a class that's focused specifically on talking about it. So how would we know how to talk about this, right? We really don't. We're learning. As the Highlander Folk School folks say, we make the road by walking. And so it's important to, while we educate and we learn and read more, to know that one book or a series of books will not make you anti-racist. So my second agreement of the four is that we agree that rigorous self-work is required. And this comes out in this theory that I'm playing with called archaeology of the self, which I'll say a couple of words about. Number three, I want to use the words of my former student and incredible scholar, Jamila Liscott. You have to know what you're fighting against as much as what you're fighting for. You know, a lot of times we get swept up in the heats of the moment, but do you really understand that when you go out to a protest or you say, I want to be anti-racist, do you fully understand what it is that you are fighting against? And therefore what you're fighting on behalf of what you're fighting for. And then finally, I think it would be wonderful if we agree that you must take a position. And this idea of neutrality, we saw in the previous quote, Ibram said, it is not possible. Sister Angela Davis says, it is not possible. And any scholar, I think, worth their weight in what they write, any race scholar, any scholar that writes about human flourishing, we'll really talk about that at some point, you know, in this movement, you have to take a position. You cannot be neutral. And for me, racial literacy is the opportunity to begin to learn how to take a position, to understand what it is you need to grapple with, what it is you need to work through as you go on this journey from, for some people, being an ally, an accomplice, and a co-conspirator. You can't just jump to that. There has to be some literacy that you are building as you are moving forward in the journey of racial literacy. And so I never quote myself until today. That was a joke, everyone. Oh, someone got my joke. Thank you, Jane, for laughing at that. But in an article I wrote in 2011, I said that racial literacy, and again, my world is really primarily teacher education. Racial literacy and teacher education calls for self-reflection in moral, political, and cultural decisions about how teachers can be catalysts for societal change. First, by learning about systems of injustice, and then explicitly teaching their students what they have learned through the use, I'm an English teacher, so the use of dialogue, critical text, journaling, helping them to develop their critical thinking and their conversation skills around the topics of racism, discrimination, and prejudice. Last, racial literacy asks that teachers take action against injustice in their school settings once they recognize it. And this is actually my attempt to put myself in conversation with Ibram's work. As Ibram, throughout the book, really talks about what it means to be racist one moment and anti-racist the next. Or what does it mean to do like that deep self-examination around how you've been socialized around race? And that once you come to the knowledge, right, of understanding the imbalance, the inequity, the racism, you are required to take action. And in this case, it is to be anti-racist and to make moves in your life and in your sphere of influence to encourage others to be anti-racist as well. And so why explore racial literacy? I've worked with this definition. I modified it as I thought about the Mailman School of Public Health and those of us who go into clinical services or be service professionals, as well as teachers. And I offer that individuals who develop racial literacy are able to engage in the necessary personal reflection. That is key, the personal reflection, the archaeology of self. About their racial beliefs and practices, and to teach their students and their clients to do the same. Most teachers and service professionals can complete their graduate programs without having experienced deep and sustaining conversations about race and how it impacts their personal and professional lives. When these individuals enter classrooms or workspaces, clinical spaces, they are not prepared to work with a diverse group of people. And when I talk about diversity, although I'm labeling it under racial literacy, as you'll see in a few moments with some posters of racial literacy roundtables, we're talking about race as it intersects with ableism, with sexual orientation, with gender, with religion. We are complex and nuanced beings. We are not just our race as it's been constructed. And so as we talk about racial literacy, I'm referring to the whole of us as human beings. And so in a place, to continue, that's outwardly racist, like America, it is important for members of the dominant racial category, who are, for the most part, the nation's teachers and the nation's service professionals. It's important that they adopt an anti-racist stance, and for persons of color to resist a victim stance. Racial literacy includes the ability to read, to discuss, and to write about situations that include racial inequity and racial bias. And we know, because we are 400 years, although we have had interruptions by everyday people like ourselves over the 400-year timeline, we know that there are so many of our institutions that are still influenced by the fact, or by the belief, I would say, some people thought it was fact, that Blacks are 3/5 human, or not fully human, and therefore should not have the opportunity that all humans have to flourish in life. And so since we know that we're dealing with that, with these systems that have been institutionalized, it's important to, for me, and G, I wanna thank you, to think about the institutionalizing of racial literacy. And so I thought about what, and I'm so glad Dr. Janice Robinson is here, because I mentioned the racial literacy roundtables. This came through her belief in the project, her funding. And the way to institutionalize it is to create spaces, sustaining spaces where people can do the work. And one such place for me at TC was creating the Racial Literacy Roundtable series. And this is one, Janice, I don't know if you know this, but this is the only time that at TC through a roundtable that we burned sage to clear the space, mm-hmm. that we wrote letters to our ancestors. And people really reconciled with some of their ancestors on both sides of the race, or the multiple sides of race, and brought them in conversation with themselves for present day. It was one of the most powerful roundtable experiences that I had. And as I mentioned, it's been 12 years of roundtables. And so graduate students, international scholars, middle school students, high school students have taken on, and Ingrid Chung is on the line. I want to thank Ingrid because Ingrid and some of her high school girls, and Ingrid, your poster's not here, but I remember when they came and they presented, what does it mean to be a Black girl in the 21st century? And they impacted me so much that I ended up writing about them in an article and how they brought together over 85, 90 people in the Columbia University community, but also the Harlem community. They held space for parents and students and professors and faculty members to take up this idea that they were pushing for. What does it mean to be a Black girl in the 21st century? So we've taken up issues around Black girls, issues around masculinity and race, issues around ableism, what does the body teach? Seeing and hearing multiple perspectives, making sure that we make space for the multiple identities that people carry and not just one or two. And over the years, it has evolved into what I'm calling the Racial Literacy Project. And so the second iteration of the Racial Literacy Roundtables is what I call the Racial Literacy Lecture Series. And it's anything but a lecture. In fact, they're all performances. And so Ramel Peebles offered a one-man show on the connection of race and prison, the school-to-prison pipeline. I had two educators, Kanene Holder and Misha Mosley, who are incredible educators, but also stand-up comics. And so they engaged folks in race through humor. And then invited Leroy Moore and his colleague, Lisa Tiny Gray Garcia, who are advocates for homeless folks and folks with ability, various abilities and disabilities. And they gave a stirring, I would say performance, interactive performance around racism and homelessness. And I write about this in my work. This is one such example of an article of looking at racial literacy, the need for racial literacy within teacher education, particularly how it plays out mostly with white female teachers and their male Black students. And we looked at, my colleague and I, looked at five different films, Hollywood films around education, and critiqued the opening of the films, the closing of those films, and also the tropes that were in those films that continue to push stereotypes around who Black and brown students are. And then we juxtaposed it with a documentary, Beyond the Bricks, where we looked at a real life school and followed the lives of two young Black men in Newark who dropped out of school, but also dropped back in. And just really seeing the sensationalism of the Hollywood films versus the very calm, and I would almost say mundane life of a child trying to get an education in a public school. And this is the theory that I'm working with as we come to the end of my slides. These are the six components of racial literacy development. So my goal is to add to the field because people are always saying, well, how do you do it? What does it look like? To offer this as a way. It's definitely not like a 12-step program or anything. And although it's in pyramid form, these components are not necessarily hierarchical. So for example, you don't have to gain humility before you work on your historical literacy. Those might be in tandem, that you might be humble enough to realize that you don't know a lot about the history of the nation or the history of a community you're working in, and you begin to work on that literacy. What doesn't shift for me, though, is the idea of critical love. And that has to be the basis for me of any work that we do. There has to be a profound ethical commitment to the communities that we're serving. So as a teacher, you must critically love the students who are in your care. And for me, it is a love that is akin to the love of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King that talks about love without power is anemic. It is the love that bell hooks talks about, where she talks about every child deserves to be loved, and being loved through education is a right for children to have. And certainly I think about the love that Paulo Freire talks about, loving and not attempting to save, but having this pedagogy of love, that everything we do is grounded in the love for that child or that person's liberation. And that's the critical love that I am ascribing to in this model. And I want to say a little bit about archaeology of the self, because for me, if I could redo, and I want to thank Dr. Angela Costa for helping me visualize this, but we're also talking about redoing this model, and perhaps archaeology of the self appears as a bullseye or a target in the center of this, because it is the self that will allow us to do the work, the critical work of loving, of being humble, of reflecting, of gaining historical literacy, and ultimately of interrupting. And that for me is the goal. Racial literacy is a practice theory. It doesn't just stay in this theoretical cloud. It is a practice. And the more you practice, the easier it becomes. But ultimately, it is about interrupting racism and inequality at the personal level, but also the systemic level. And so the archaeology of the self is this deep excavation and exploration of beliefs and biases and ideas that shape how we engage with our work, how we engage with others, how we engage with the world. We have to do that deep work to discover and find out where do these issues live within. And what I suggest as we excavate those stereotypes, that racism, the hate, all of those things that flatten our experiences as humans, that we replace it with a critical love. I want to share this off my Instagram. I took it from Bettina Love's Instagram when she says, and I'm speaking specifically to my white brothers and sisters, because first and foremost, the way that race has been constructed has been around whiteness and blackness. And that has stabilized power for a group and also destabilized power and influence for the other. So again, bringing in historically how all of this has been shaped, Bettina says that white supremacy, well, she posts that white supremacy won't die until white people see it as a white issue they need to solve rather than a black issue they need to empathize with. And that for me connects with archaeology of the self. And so people of color have to do their own archaeological dig around race and racism. Often it is excavating the internalized racism and some of the imposter syndrome, the self-doubt that comes in living under the smog of racism, as Beverly Daniel Tatum describes for us. And for white folks, it's kind of excavating this false sense of superiority. It's excavating how you have been really pushed from childhood and not really been interrupted unless you have progressive education and your parents were progressive thinkers, that whiteness was right and was the standard. So there's a lot of unlearning that everyone has to do. And this is why it's important to see this as a literacy, a skill that we are practicing. But it has to go beyond for white folks. It has to go beyond with the empathy. And empathy is important because it often comes out in allyship and co-conspiratorship. But there has to be an ownership, even if you don't want these benefits. If you wake up one morning and you say, I don't want this, racism doesn't care. You know, as a Black woman, I want to wake up and, you know, not be seen in this the stereotypes that flatten who I am. To some extent, I don't have a choice except with resisting within and some of the work that I do outside. So we are, as Norman Rockwell painted, you know, he painted Ruby Bridges, he named it the problem we all live with. This is the problem that we all live with. And so we must, I argue, do that self-work in order to find out what's our stand, what's our stance, and how are we going to be racially literate moving forward and moving towards change, and ultimately, as Kendi asked all of us to do, towards being anti-racist. And so the next level of racial literacy for me is this idea of co-conspiratorship. I'm inspired by my dear friend, Dr. Bettina Love, her book that has now sold over 110,000 copies within a year. Just amazing and wonderful. And she talks about this notion of co-conspirator. And she says, this is not in her book, but this was in an Education Week article a couple of weeks ago. She says that to become anti-racist, white people must acknowledge their power, right? And so when you realize you sit in a seat of power, you understand the levers that you can pull towards change. And change looks different for everyone. And so I want to bring in the wonderful work of Britt Hawthorne, who has offered this just within the last couple of months, this idea of a pyramid of accountability, of seeing yourself as an active ally, as an accomplice, or as a co-conspirator, which is what Bettina Love writes about. And a couple of months ago, Britt Hawthorne beautifully fleshed out this idea as a way of helping to give people an opportunity to build their racial literacy, to understand what does it really mean to be an active ally? What does it mean to be an accomplice? And if I am progressing or want to progress towards being a co-conspirator, what does it really mean? Bettina Love talks about it means putting something on the line for someone else. And so I end my talk here by bringing in my auntie, Maya Angelou. Remember, I am related to a whole host of people, but Maya Angelou certainly is an ancestor who deeply inspires me. And I want to share that as you continue to read Kendi's book, as you continue to engage with videos, with reading other books, as you continue to build your racial literacy and decide where you stand and what stance you're going to take, and whether it will be in the form of an ally or an accomplice or a co-conspirator, just know that once we see, we cannot unsee. And as Auntie Maya reminded us, that when we know better, we do better. And with that, I open up for any conversations and questions for the time that we have left.